Hello and welcome to video lecture series in Sociology. Today we are going to discuss chapter 8 titled as Social Movements from your textbook Social Change and Development in India. For understanding, we have divided this chapter into 6 parts. So far, we have discussed about the definition and features of social movement, how social movements are decisive in bringing about change in society. We have talked about types of social movements, particularly new and old social movements, about civil society, theories of social movements and stages in the life of a social movement. We have also discussed examples of chipko and tribal movements in the previous lectures. Today, we are going to discuss about class and caste based and women's movement as examples of other types of movements. Now, being organized forms of collective actions, social movements intend to bring about or resist a kind of change in society. They are vehicles for social change. We have discussed both about chipko and tribal movements and shown that how these movements were based on environment. Today, we'll discuss about the social movements that have attempted to change or challenge the existing social structure, norms or values, particularly the peasants and the caste-based movements, working class movements and women's movements. Let us begin with peasants' movements. Now, peasants' movements or movements by peasants or agrarian struggles have been taking place since pre-colonial times. But initially, these movements were local and disjointed in nature. They were confined to specific issues and to particular areas or regions only, such as Bengal Revolt of 1859 against the indigo plantation and the Deccan Riots of 1857 against moneylenders only. Interestingly, during colonialism, these movements became linked with the nationalist movement or the freedom struggle. Peasant movements under the leadership of Mahatma Gandhi were also seen as major events in the freedom struggle. The Bardoli Satyagraha in 1928 in Surat was a non-tax campaign. It was a part of nationwide Asahyog Andolan, that is non-cooperation movement. It was a campaign of refusal to pay land revenue. The Champaran Satyagraha in 1718 was also against indigo plantation. In the 1920s, few movements emerged against the forest policies of the British government and the local rulers. Between 1920 and 40, few peasant organizations emerged. The first one to emerge was called as Bihar Provincial Kisan Sabha, established in 1929, and the All India Kisan Sabha in 1936. These organizations demanded freedom from peasant workers and all other classes from economic exploitation. At the time of independence, there were two important cases of peasants' movement. One is Tebhaga movement in 1946 and 47, and other one is Telangana movement from 1946 to 51. Now, let's discuss about Tebhaga movement briefly. As the name suggests, Tebhaga, you know, from teen part or three parts, was a struggle of sharecroppers in Bengal and North Bihar for 2/3 share of their produce instead of the half that they were getting conventionally. The Kisan Sabha and the Communist Party of India, that is the CPI, supported the movement. Telangana movement was direct against the feudal conditions in the princely state of Hyderabad and was led by CPI again. The central concern for the peasants was land, but the nature and the issue changed after India gained independence. After independence, the important issues were land reforms, zamindari abolition, declining importance of land revenue and public credit system. The new farmers' movements began in 1970s in Punjab and Tamil Nadu, the regions of the Green Revolution particularly. These movements were regionally organized, were non-party and also involved farmers rather than just the peasants. Now, these movements were anti-state and anti-urban. The focus of their demand was related to the pricing of the crop, which has gone up because of the Green Revolution. For example, procurement price of rice or for any other cereal for that matter, buying price of the crop, prices of agricultural inputs, taxation, subsidies, non-repayment of loans, etc. These were the concerns for the new farmers or peasants movement after independence. These people used new methods of agitation like road and railway blockages, not letting officials and leaders to enter the village. In some cases, the farmer movements have broadened their agenda and ideology to include environment and women's issues as well. Due to this, they have become part of the worldwide new social movements combining the old and the new movements. Now, let us discuss about caste-based movements. Caste-based movements usually have a particular character. Most of these movements involve Dalits. If you look at the social movements of the Dalits, they are not just movements about economic exploitation or political oppression. What do we mean by a Dalit for that matter? Dalit means the poor and the oppressed people. It refers to those who have been deliberately kept at the bottom of the social hierarchy by those who are above them in the social hierarchy. This includes social, cultural, political, and economic oppression of the people called as Dalits. The term Dalit was first used by new Buddhist activities, the followers of Baba Saheb Ambedkar in early 1970s. The word Dalit indicates denial of any right as a human being and justifies caste hierarchy and discrimination. They are a struggle for self-determination, recognition as a fellow human being, for dignity, for respect and self-confidence. But there has not been any pan-Indian Dalit movement and they have mainly remained region or area specific. These struggles or movements are for abolishing discriminatory practices against caste, untouchability and stigmatization. These movements were initiated during the social reform movement in India in early 20th century. Different movements with different ideologies have highlighted different issues pertaining to Dalits. But all of them assert or stand for a Dalit identity. Again, there is no precise meaning of what they mean by it, but the issues or concerns are against discrimination. Despite differences in the nature of Dalit movements and the meaning of identity, there has been a common quest for equality, self-dignity, and eradication of untouchability and for the respect of these people. Some of the major Dalit movements are the Satnami movements in Chhattisgarh plains in eastern Madhya Pradesh, Adi Dharma movement in Punjab, the Mahar movement in Maharashtra. The socio-political mobilization among the Jatavs of Agra and anti-Brahmin movement in South India. There is a surge in identity-based movements in contemporary India. And much of the politics in present India is based on the issue of identity and is mobilizing Dalits to a large extent. Like peasant movements, the backward caste movements have emerged both in colonial and post-colonial contexts. During colonialism, much of the structure of state and society and privileges were based upon the caste status and caste divisions. And somehow, the caste system entered the institutional life. The horizontal unity between castes strengthened as groups united themselves. But interestingly, they began to lose its ritual content and became more secularized for political mobilization. The term backward classes was first used late in 19th century. It was used in Madras Presidency from 1872, in the princely state of Mysore since 1918, and in Bombay Presidency from 1925. Since 1920s, a number of caste-based organizations have emerged in different parts of the country representing the backward castes, or which are also called as the backward classes. The increasing visibility and participation of Dalits and OBCs in politics and social movements of self-assertion led to a resurgence of a feeling of collectivity among the upper caste as a reaction. The presence of caste in modern India is widely debated. It has been argued that positions of power and privilege have been occupied and dominated by the upper caste people. Whereas upper caste claim that with increasing opportunities and secularization, caste distinctions no longer hold any importance or any meaning and the caste system is breaking down. You must be aware of the ideological divide on the issue of reservation between different caste communities. It is claimed that as compared to the pre-independence era, the socio-economic condition of all social groups, including the Dalits, caste and tribes, has improved. But the core issue remains that how much has it improved? How these groups, especially the downtrodden sections, stand in comparison to the rest of the population? Scholars point out to the existence of caste and class nexus in contemporary times. Although we also agree that in modern industrial and urban societies, a variety of occupations and professions are available for people belonging to any caste category. Even in villages, caste-based division of labor is not strictly followed and it's breaking down. But this does not change the social reality that is overwhelmingly majority of those in the position of power are belonging to upper caste. Like caste and peasant movements, worker movements also emerged in India during the colonial rule. As you know, industrialization began in India during the late 19th century. The business and trade was initially catering to the needs of the British government. Raw material was procured from India and finished goods were made in England. They were then back sold in the Indian market. The factories were established in the port cities of Madras, Calcutta, Bombay. Tea plantation was also developed in Assam. During earlier years of industrialization in India, the colonial government did not regulate the wages or working conditions of the worker. The labor was cheap and plenty here. But gradually, workers realized and started to think about their rights. The formal trade unions emerged late, but in the beginning there were some protests only. Workers were also drawn into the anti-colonial movement. Although the First World War led to the expansion of industries, but it also resulted in a great deal of misery of the workers world over. There was a sharp increase in the prices of commodities along with a massive food shortage. There were waves of strikes, particularly in the textile mills in Bombay. In just 2 months of September and October in the year 1970s, there were around 30 strikes by workers. Jute workers in Calcutta also went on strike. In Madras, the workers of Buckingham and Carnatic mills, called as Binney mills popularly, went on strike demanding increase in wages. Textile workers in Ahmedabad organized strike for 50% increase in wages. B.P. Wadia, a social worker and a member of Theosophical Society, established the first trade union in April 1918 in Madras. The same year, Mahatma Gandhi founded the Textile Labour Association. All India Trade Union Congress, called as AITUC, was established in Bombay in 1920. This was quite broad-based, involving diverse ideologies and challenged colonial government's apathy. As a result, the government passed Factories Act, reducing working hours to 10 hours per day and started formal registration of trade unions in India. By 1920, AITUC had 25,000 members with over 200 unions affiliated to it. Around independence, AITUC got split into two factions, with each faction aligning its interest with a major political party. AITUC was being controlled by the communist, whereas INTUC, that is Indian National Trade Union Congress, by the Congress. Later, regional parties too started influencing or forming their unions representing workers' issues. During 1974, there was a major strike by railway workers. During the emergency from 1975 to 77, the government curbed all trade union activities. The workers' movement during the emergency was very much part of the general struggle for civil rights among people. But now, as globalization poses a new set of challenges, the nature of issues worker movements fight for also have changed. Along with civil liberties, new issues have come. What are these new issues? These new issues have become part of new movements which look for not just better wages, but also for better facilities and provisions at the workplace or in factories. They ask for leave benefits, medical benefits, retirement and pension schemes, women's issues including provision of daycare facilities for children of working women, gender equality at workplace, equal work and equal pay issues. A number of women's organizations at local and international level have also emerged during the 20th century. The Women's India Association in 1917 was the first to begin with. All India Women's Conference, AIWC, was established in 1926. National Council for Women in India was established in 1925. These are some of the organizations set up during the social reform movement and freedom struggle. These organizations focused on women's issues, although they began with a limited focus but gradually widened their interest and functional areas also. For instance, AIWCE began with the idea that women's welfare and politics were two separate subjects or spheres. Later, it was realized that, can the Indian man or woman be free if India remains a slave? How can we remain dumb about national freedom, the very basis for all the great reforms? So they decided that women must participate in the fight for freedom. The social movements created an environment in which women issues could no longer be ignored. But at the same time, women were also part of the freedom struggle. In fact, women participated in peasants, tribal and social reform movements and also in worker movements in large numbers. They were also involved in the process of nation building in the post-independent India. 1970s saw a revival of women's movements in India. It was also the period of second phase of feminism emerging world over. Although the central concerns were similar to the previous movements, but now there was a different ideology, strategy and organizational structure of these movements. The new concerns included domestic violence, gender equality at the workplace, same wages, equality of opportunity for women in the same profession, breaking of glass ceiling, reservation for women. Although all women are discriminated against men, but there are different concerns for different categories of women, such as educated or working women, Dalit or upper caste women. Interestingly, what has happened now, there has been a growing understanding that even men are constrained by social norms, not just women. For example, men in patriarchal society feel, or they are taught to feel, that they must be strong and successful. Men are not expected to express their emotions. A gender-just society allows freedom to both men and women. The issues when we talk of gender are no longer confined to women only. They involve men as well as women. Women's movement advocated for the rights of the movement, but gender issues are concerned about both men and women together. Read more about social movements to enhance your understanding about gender-based movements, women's movement, tribal movement, or caste-based movements. To conclude, let's quickly summarize this chapter. We began discussing features of social movement in this chapter. We discussed about social movement and how social movement is a vehicle for social change. We discussed about various types of social movements, namely reformist, revolutionary, redemptive, alternative, reactionary. We differentiated between new and old social movements. We discussed about various theories of social movements and also about the stages in the life of a social movement. Then towards the end, we understood broad categories of social movements like environmental movement and taking specific cases of Chipkok Andolan, caste-based movements, tribal movements, workers and women's movements in detail. So this is all about the story of social movements. You enjoy reading this chapter. Thank you.